Good morning and a very warm welcome to St. James Church. Good morning, Grace. Good to see you, yes. So it's good to see you this morning. If you are new or you're watching this live, my name is Fabian. I'm the vicar of St. James, and we are our final service before the summer break. So our children will still start the service with us, and then they will go to their children church. And we are going to come to the end also of our series on the Holy Spirit. And so Ed Hoskins is going then to kind of summarize, look back, and reflect of how we can continue to grow in our understanding of who the Holy Spirit is and the kind of work that he does in faith communities like ourselves and in our own personal lives. So if this is the first time for you, we have communion today, and you're very warmly welcomed to participate in that. You will see that there will be things on the screens for all of us to respond to. We'll have a time of singing, a time of looking at scripture, unpacking that, and a time of prayer. So I do hope you will feel very warmly welcomed, and that you will. One of the theme in our church is encountering God, and we want each occasions, not just on Sunday, but each time we meet, that we are encountering God in the way we need it. For some of you, you are in a place where you need to encounter God's comfort, maybe God's hope, God's grace, or maybe in a good place, and you just want to encounter God in worship and in gratitude. So hopefully there will be enough in this service for you to do that. We start with our notices. So if you are not in our email list, there are weekly bulletins in print version at the back, and they are in big format now, so it's much easier to see. And if you would like us to send it by email, there is a card at the back. You can fill your details and your email address, and then we will put you on our email list. This afternoon, all the churches in Taunton are gathering at Vivery Park at 3:30. So you can bring a packed lunch, a little bit of food, and there will be then time to meet with other people. They will also have a time of singing and testimonies and some games. So it is a fun time to be together at the start of kind of the summer break. And then in the main hall at 7 o'clock, we have the room, which is our last service before the summer break. And again, we'll be looking back, and that's 1 hour of contemporary singing and looking at some of the issues in our world today and how it applies to our Christian faith. Yes, and so from next week, we are moving into our summer services, which are all ages, so families, children will all be together for the next few Sundays. And an important change in, we will have our communion service on the second and the fourth Sunday just for August. So normally it's the first and the third. For the summer services, our communion service will be on the second and the fourth Sunday. And if I can ask Jenny to come forward and just share a little bit about something heritage happening in our church. Yes.
Coming here on a Sunday, you might not realise that during the week the church is open Monday to Friday, and people very often come in if they're on their holidays or they're going to the cricket ground. But in September, there is something bigger happening in that Heritage Open Days, which is a national thing, encourage historic buildings to open up the bits and pieces that people don't normally see. And this gives us a fantastic opportunity to share the story of our church, because this is a living building. It's been here 900 odd years, and a lot of people have come in and gone out from here. And it's an opportunity to tell the story of our faith alongside that of our history. Now, we'll have the tower open, we'll have teas and coffees, we'll have some displays. But what we do need more is some people to come and staff those days on the 7th and the 14th of September. So there's a notice in the bulletin, and I expect to be overwhelmed by the number of people who will want to see me afterwards, who will want to participate, because we could make this quite interactive, and that could be really exciting. Is everyone excited by history? Come on. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. As we start, shall we all stand as we have our opening words together? And the words in bold and kind of reddish are for you to respond to. Rushing wind of the Spirit, breathe new life into us. Blazing flame of the Spirit, burn away our fears. Comforting presence of the Spirit, heal our wounds. And renew the face of your creation. Spirit of God, come upon us and kindle in us the fire of your love. Equip us and help us to proclaim God's good news in all that we do. And we'll have our opening songs. These are the days of Elijah. Our time of confession, we have words for us to say all together, and at the end of that, in a way to reflect on our own lives, but also to ask God's grace, forgiveness, but also to fill us with Holy Spirit. I'm going to use again a reading that I did, I think, about 2 or 3 weeks ago, just as a way to ask God to bless us and forgive us. So, Heavenly Father, the sacrifice acceptable to you is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart you will not despise. So together we say, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing. Renew a right spirit within us, and restore unto us the joy of your salvation. O Spirit of the living God, thou light and fire divine, descend upon thy church once more, and make it truly thine. Fill it with love and joy and power, with righteousness and peace, till Christ shall dwell in our hearts and sin and sorrow cease. Blow, wind of God, with wisdom blow, until our minds are free from mists of error, clouds of doubt, which blind our eyes to thee. Burn, winged fire, inspire our lips with flaming love and zeal to preach to all thy great good news, God's glorious common weal. Teach us to utter living words of truth which all may hear, the language all may understand when love speaks loud and clear, till every age and race and clime shall blend their creeds in one, and earth shall form one family by whom thy will is done. So shall we know the power of Christ who came this world to save. So shall we rise with him to life which soars beyond the grave. And earth shall win true holiness which makes thy children whole, till perfected by thee we reach creation's glorious goal. And with those final words, let's take a time to praise God, and I will ask the worship team to introduce this time now.
Good morning, everybody. Normally when I do praise times, I find Bible links to the songs which we're singing. Decided to do something slightly different here, where I found out the reason behind why they wrote the songs. Okay, so the first one is King of Kings, Majesty. That's by an artist called Jared Cooper. He's a mission pastor in Hull, and he's also does Days of Wonder, which is a website which he runs. King of Kings is an attempt to summarize the story of the gospel and the church. This song is firmly rooted in scripture and packed full of theology. Theology releases praise. We hope and we pray that the song articulates the heart of the gospel and the story of the church, starting with the birth of Jesus and through Pentecost, and then placing ourselves within that story with the birth of the church and our salvation stories. Hopefully, it becomes a song that we can sing every week as a reminder of who we are in our origins and also our future. It's leaning towards liturgy, and in the way with a devotional angle where people can find themselves in the journey of the song and give praise to God. When we believe correctly about God, when we understand and get a greater revelation of who God is and what he has done, we can't help but respond in worship. The second song, Hear I Cry, O King of Heavens, is by Tim Hughes and another artist called Martin Smith, who was of the band Delirious, which I went to see in Bristol before they broke up. When they got together to write that song, they first had this piano lead melody, and they were thinking about the state of the nation we live in, and a prayer and dedication to see God's kingdom come here on earth. Mainly thinking about the Father and the healing of the land, as both artists are British, they were mainly thinking about the state of Britain. But this song can be applied to any nation. They primarily wrote this song for a big conference which has been held at the Royal Albert Hall and wanted to have a song which a prayer which everyone could sing along to and understand. And the final song, We'll Walk the Land with Hearts on Fire by Graham Kendrick. All three of the songs we are singing in our praise time are all well-known British song worship leaders who are the forefront of British songs we sing today. The lyrics convey a series of rally and calling for empowerment towards change. The first verse urges for a passionate journey towards change. walk in the land with hearts on fire and every step becoming a prayer. The second verse acknowledges the longevity of the flame, burning bright for 2,000 years, showing that it can still ignite the souls of people awakening. The chorus encourages the flame to burn brighter, turning night into glorious day, while the song grows louder and the love grows stronger. The third verse speaks of the unity of the people, flowing as one heart and one song. The lyrics call for the renewal of the compassion of Christ in all nations, as our captain, the King of Kings, calls for us to be faithful and true, answering like thunder with Jesus, Master, with you. Mm-hmm. Please stand for our first song and sing out to the Lord.
Thank you.
Jesus, it is our prayer that our song will grow louder as you pour out your love in us. And may your light of love, truth, and hope shine ever brighter in this church, across this town, and around the world. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, and we're going to have now our two readings.
The first reading is from Ezekiel 37, and I have a vague memory of reading this here about 7 years ago. So let's listen afresh to God's word. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth amongst them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will breathe breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life, and stood upon their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, our hope is gone, and we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back from the land, back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your gates, when I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live.'" That was the word of the Lord.
The second reading is from Revelation chapter 3, verse 1 to 6. "To the angel of the church in Sardis write, 'These are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds, and you have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains is about to die. For I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard, obey it and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is the word of God.
Good morning. It's a while since I stood up here, so I'm pleased to be back and share some thoughts with you. What do you remember the last 11 weeks? Depending on your outlook, you might remember different things, not just those things. You may have had family occasions, you may have had other things in the last 11 weeks. And of course, some of these things happen regularly. But the D-Day 80 is, I think there was a D-Day 70 in terms of the number of years since D-Day. Every decade, there are some things like the voting, which is irregular, but 5 years or less. And then some things are at a regular pace, like the Euros every 4 or 5 years? 4 years, I think. Wimbledon every year. So some things come regularly. Some things we're reminded of more often. Some things we wait perhaps a bit longer. What do you remember the last 11 weeks in church? There's a challenge. Or maybe in your house groups. So I'll give you a moment to think, and you should have had a prompt earlier, or it should have been, we were prompted earlier by Fabian, that we've been talking about the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. So the last 11 weeks, since I think it was the 5th of May. So I thought we'd have a little test. So we've had 11 weeks on the Holy Spirit. And again, I'll give you a moment or two to think, can you remember any of the titles or the themes? So I thought I'd start by giving you the first one. There we go. So we say, back on the 5th of May, Fabian introduced this series where he used these words, reveal, revive, restore, and renew. And just to remind you that the reveal was about how the Holy Spirit reveals things to us. That he reveals truths about God. The Holy Spirit working through us helps us to understand the teachings of Jesus. It reveals truths. Revive is more about reviving, giving new life. Giver of life. Restore, you may remember Fabian talked about it, that Lectio 365 talks about restoried, a new story. And maybe it gives us a new story. The Holy Spirit revives the sort of story of our lives and gives us a new story. And then the renew is all about perhaps renewing our direction, giving us a new path, a new outlook. So having mentioned those, any ideas of the others? Well, I'm not really going to give you a test. I think that would be a bit cruel. And I'm not even going to go through those lists. But they are the titles of the various weeks we've had since the 5th of May. And hopefully something of that has you've taken on board or you've remembered. I wouldn't expect you to remember them all. I don't remember them all. I wasn't here for them all. Maybe you weren't here for them all. But if you are inspired to think about it afresh and come back to it, you can, of course, access all of those through the church website, onto YouTube, and see the actual presentations. And I have indeed done that for some of the ones I missed because I wanted to make sure I'd understand a bit of what you have heard that I perhaps hadn't. But if you think about those first four words, they all start with RE. Now, RE is a prefix, is often a prefix which means again. It perhaps doesn't work quite so well for reveal, which is a sort of separate word. But revive, it says bring new life again. The RE in front of things emphasizes doing something again. The restore is bring us back again, restore something to its previous condition. Maybe the renew, when we talk about renewing us and giving us a new, renewing our life, giving us a new outlook. So I want you to keep that in mind, that the re means again, and it's alive, it's an active thing. It's not just a once-off thing, it's an active renewing, bringing about again. So what more can I say? That's really it, isn't it? So you can go home and do the homework. You can go home and look up all the various bits you've missed or revived. But no, we need to perhaps look a little bit more about the readings you've had today. And I'd like to say the next few words quite loud. So, wake up! because we had that in Revelations. Wake up and strengthen what remains, for your deeds are unfinished. Now again, this is about looking forward. Whatever has happened in the past, do something again. You need to reappraise what deeds you have, what your path in life is. And again, it's reminding us, if you like, another RE, reminding us, bring back to our memories what our deeds are. If to be able to say our deeds are unfinished, as it said in our text in Revelation, we need to think, well, what are our deeds? What are we here to do? What is our life about? Remember, revise, be reminded. This is not a unique, it's not a one-only thing in the Bible, this wake-up phrase. In Ephesians 5, when Paul is writing to the Ephesians, he says, "For once you were once in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord, and live as children of light, and find out what pleases the Lord." So again, it's back to this. If your deeds are undone, you need to find out what pleases the Lord. And then Paul goes on to say, and this is why it says, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." He's almost saying, once you've found out what God wants for you, wake up. You know, get up and do something about it. And then in Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians, again, Paul writes to the church in Thessalonia. He says, "So let us not be like others who are asleep." So let's not be the sleepy ones. Let us not be those who are asleep, but be awake and sober. And I like this idea of sober, or fit mind. You're not a dulled mind who's a bit sort of not quite, you know, functioning, but of sound mind, keen, alive. So that's a little bit about the letter, the lesson we had from the Revelation. So let's look at Ezekiel. I said to Fabian when he suggested I should preach on this week. I said, "Oh, I like Ezekiel. And I do. I think Ezekiel's full of all sorts of lovely, active, vibrant imagery." But I'm not going to talk about Ezekiel very much, actually. But just to give you some background, Ezekiel was prophesying at a time when Jerusalem had been sacked by the Babylonians, the temple had been destroyed, and they were in exile in Babylon. And indeed, I think Ezekiel was there with them. And you'll remember in Psalm 137, that by the rivers of Babylon we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. And they're sitting in Babylon, remembering how things were, and their hope is gone. And Ezekiel's full of the Spirit himself, has this prophecy, this vision of these dry bones with no hope, completely dead, nothing to give any sign of life. And he's saying, "But son of man," and thank you, by the way, Andrew, for reading the next verse. I think the text was going to stop at 10, but 11 is where that gives the real image, real description of why he's giving this prophecy. "Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel." So the bones represent God's people. "They say, our bones are dried and our hope is gone. We are cut off." And again, you can understand that from being cut off from their precious temple in Jerusalem, cut off from their homeland. And therefore, Ezekiel prophesies, "I will bring you back to the land of Israel. I will put my spirit in you and you will live." Great signs of hope, of encouragement. So I think at times we feel we have perhaps not much hope for the world. We wonder where things are going, what's happening. And we need to be re-energized by the Spirit. Again, a re-word, energized again. And so, of course, Ezekiel's message was that God would indeed restore his people back to Jerusalem. And then Revelation 3 again. "I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead." You know, so do we have a reputation? You know, what do we as St. James's Church, what do we as individuals have? You know, how do people see us? Do we have a reputation of being a bit dull, perhaps being a bit drunk? Sorry, not drunk, obviously, but perhaps not as sober as we should be, perhaps not awake as we should be. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. "Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard." And again, this RE, remember, bring back to mind. It also says, "Hold it fast." I like that idea of holding it fast, keeping it active in your head. Keep it in mind. And quite often, there's a number of phrases in the Old Testament which talks about remember and keep. And you'll remember the fourth commandment, no doubt, why we're here today. Remember the Sabbath day. Now, I often in my head think it's remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. But it's not. It's remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Or by keeping it holy. So by keeping it in mind, by making Sunday special, we are prompted to remember. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy, making it special, keeping it in mind. And this sort of memory is not just a memory of what we have done ourselves. I'm jumping ahead a bit slightly. You also remember in the Old Testament, it often talks about, remember you were slaves in Egypt. In Deuteronomy, often it says, remember you were slaves in Egypt. So it's talking to the people of Israel, saying that they were once in Egypt and then come through the Exodus. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way out of the wilderness for 40 years. And you start to think, well, 40 years, a generation, it can't be the people he's talking to in Deuteronomy aren't the people who came, who were the slaves. They're generations after. And again, in Psalms, often, I remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I remember the miracles of long ago. I remember, Lord, your ancient laws and find comfort in them. I remember the days of long ago. I meditate on all your work and consider what your hands have done. This type of memory is not memory of what you've done yourself, but remembering that these things had happened. We don't necessarily have the full experience of the Holy Spirit sort of working in our lives, but we can remember that other people do. We can remember that from Pentecost, of what happened in the early church. So remember is not just remember what you have experienced yourself, but remember that these things have happened. Keep in mind. Remember and keep. So when in Revelation 3 it says, remember therefore what you have received and heard, it's you've received a message. It's not remember what you've experienced. You've received a message. You've heard a message. Hold on to it. Hold fast and repent. Repent, another word with R-E in the beginning. I'm not going to focus on repent now particularly, but R-E again, repent, return again. Repent means to return round, to turn again. So having said so much about remembering and holding things fast, how will you hold it fast, it being some message about the Holy Spirit that we've received in the last 11 weeks? I sometimes wear this bangle. It's nothing very special. It was made by an artisan sort of maker of metalwork. But it's got brass, it's got copper, and it's got steel in it. And I wear it sometimes to deliberately remind myself of the Trinity. And I like to think if I wore it regularly, I'd think of the Trinity more often. But I think sometimes we might focus on Christ, we might focus on the Father, and the whole point of this series has been to focus us on the Holy Spirit, and we have to think of the Trinity being the three persons of God together, such as these metals are bound together in my bangle. We have all sorts of imagery of the Holy Spirit, of the Trinity being God, Father, Son, and Spirit, bound together. And I sometimes ponder as to which of these is representing the Spirit, which is representing God, the God the Father, which is and God the Son. And then I think, ooh, does it matter? They are bound together. They are one. And so we need to be reminded. We need to perhaps to hold fast in our minds the message of our last 11 weeks that the Spirit is with us when we think of God the Father, when we think of God the Son. And it should be a natural way of thinking of God as Spirit. And so what will you remember? Of the last series, I'm not going to go through it at all, but of the last 11 weeks, you might remember thinking back about Ruach, that wonderful word of the breath of God. And I think it was Nick who was saying that Ruach is a female noun. And so we can think of the Spirit as female, if that helps. But we think of Ruach, the breath of God, active at creation, but still ongoing, recreation. And there's all sorts of other themes we had of transformative, of guide and comforter, of purifying and anointing. So much that we can think about in terms of what happened in the last week. And it's not to remember as a thing that is past, but to remember as something that continues to be in our minds. So just a little bit more about these things. I find it immensely an immense privilege if I think of Ruach, the breath of God at creation, that power of the Spirit which created the cosmos, is also in me. It's in all of us. The Spirit of God, we are part of that creative power of the whole universe. And then you might find, say, have comfort of thinking of the Spirit as a comforter alongside you when you have difficulties, or a guide in terms of where you are going in your life. And it's all about this action, this active work of the Spirit, which is ongoing. But of course, this is not really the end of the series. The series was there to give us a focus, but the theme continues. And as Paul says in 1 Corinthians, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst, dwells in each of us? God's Spirit is in us. And as Fabian, I think, said it was last, no, it wasn't here last week, the week before that, that we are all therefore charismatic. I think there's a problem with the word charismatic, that we sometimes reserve it for someone who's, we might almost want to put on a pedestal, someone who's got particular spiritual powers, who has particular spiritual gifts. But we're all charismatic in the sense that the Spirit is in all of us. It's charismatic, the word, actually means gift or grace. It's a gift of God. It's the gift of the Holy Spirit to all of us. Say, too often reserved for special powers, but in a true sense, it is the work of the Holy Spirit giving us spiritual gifts in our everyday life, ongoing. And so I'll just put these words out. We won't say this prayer quite yet, but the words for this service were really revive, restore, renew. So think of that re, it's again. It's constantly again, again and again and again. Revive our passion. Restore our expectation, renew our path. And that should be something that whether we remember the detail of the last 11 weeks, we can remember the principle that the Holy Spirit is with us here and now, around us, within us. We can share our experiences with each other. Whenever we think of God the Father, that is also God the Spirit. Whenever we think of God the Son, that is also God the Spirit. The Spirit is the essence of us being here today. And so let us pray together. O Holy Spirit, we pray that you will revive our passion for the good news, restore our expectation and faith, and renew our path. Amen.
Thank you. If I can invite Roger now to come for our time of church prayer.
There is a response this morning. I am choosing this morning to focus our intercessions not on asking God to be active in sorting the many concerns we have, but to spend this time thanking God for his overwhelming generosity, grace, and love, something which we can never do too often. Let us cast our minds back to when we first realized that God loved us. In a thousand different ways, as appropriate to each of us as individuals and in our individual circumstances, the Holy Spirit impacted us. What a blessing that we recognize this was Almighty God, Creator of all, pleading with us to recognize him and welcome him in. This was totally undeserved and unmerited. It was simply by God's grace. Thank you that we are able to say yes. Thank you that we glimpse the light of our Saviour Jesus, a light that burns for us more brightly now. Jesus, our risen Lord, we trust in your goodness and mercy. Let us cast our minds back to when we began to realize just how much Jesus had done to make a relationship with him possible. Our minds struggle to conceive the immensity of the cost to him. Such is your love of all humanity that for you no price was too much. You are the author, the founder, the alpha of love. Love starts from you. Thank you that we know you love us. Thank you that we can accept this love. We can in turn have the joy to love others, and in turn again, the joy of being loved by others. This is all from you. Jesus, our risen Lord,
we trust in your goodness.
Let us cast our minds back to when we realized that the Holy Bible was real, true, and your living word. Your guide to us on how to live a life worth living. Thank you that you have ensured its preservation through the ages in order that we can read it and benefit from it. Thank you that we have the freedom to pass it on to the next generation. Jesus, our risen Lord, let us cast our minds back to those times when we have moved away from God or simply been too distracted and forgotten you. Times when the Bible story of the prodigal son and his father became a reality for us. And we experience the Father rushing to greet us and whooping with joy on our return. Thank you, Father. Your love for us has no end. Jesus, our risen Lord,
we trust in your goodness and mercy.
Let us cast our minds forward. You love us now and through all eternity. When you call us home, the challenges of this earthly life will be put down and forgotten. We will receive your love, unfettered, undistorted, unlimited, and forever. Jesus, our risen Lord,
we trust in your goodness and
mercy. I'm going to pause for a few minutes now to give each of us the opportunity to silently thank God for individual things that are important to you. I'm going to add to those prayers. We're praying for the Tall family, Nick and his family this morning in their difficult times. Saying thank you is not enough. We don't have sufficient language to fully express our gratitude. So, in words, we must simply be a thank you. But we know that it is our actions in following Jesus that gives you the most pleasure and is the clearest expression of our gratitude. Fill us with your Spirit as we receive communion in a few minutes to turn words into actions. Jesus, our risen Lord, and we finish by saying together, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you so very much, Roger. And if I can ask the church to keep us in our prayer, tomorrow we have the school leavers in this church. And it's a kind of a big organization. They will have a service, and then we'll offer them a lunch and some activities. They can climb the tower. Finally, after 6 years, they have to wait 6 years before they can climb the tower. So they're really excited. But do pray for us and the volunteers, and that will be a great day also for all the children there. So it is the time when we share the peace. If this is new for you, we will say the words on the screen, and then you might have a stranger coming to you and shaking your hand and greeting you with those words, the peace of the Lord be with you. You might want to respond and also with you, or you might just shake each other's hands. It's just a way to show that we are a family. And whether you've been here for decades or just this is the first time, we want you to feel part of this family, a family that learns to love God, to love others, and to respect who God has made us and the gift we have. God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us and has pledged, and as a pledge of what is to come, has given the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. So the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let us show one another a sign of God's peace. If you are able to do remain standing, but if you need to sit down at any point, do so. The Lord is here.
His Spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, who is your living Word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us into your own image. To you be glory and praise forever. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. To you be glory and praise forever. Today we give you thanks because in fulfillment of your promise, you pour out your Spirit upon us, filling us with your gifts, leading us into all truth, and uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith. Your Spirit gives us grace to call you Father, to proclaim your gospel to all nations, and to serve you as royal priesthood. Therefore, we join our voices with angels and archangels, and with all those in whom the Spirit dwells, to proclaim the glory of your name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread. He gave you thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." To you be glory and praise forever. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which he shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." To you be glory and praise forever. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember now his sacrifice of himself, made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and we look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love and unite us into the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessed and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated and join me with the prayer Jesus taught us. Jesus taught us to call God our Father. So in faith and trust we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All are welcome to share the table. There are two stations, and people will lead you. If you want just prayer, you can also come, and we will then give you a blessing. If I can ask those who are helping me to come forward first.
Let's take just a moment of quietness as we, in our own hearts, express our gratitude for God's love shown in Jesus and the assurance through him that death is not the end and that God has a plan to renew and revive and restore once and for all his whole creation. Amen. Coming to the end of our service, and we'll have our final song. So if you still have the energy to stand up, we will sing together, Rejoice, Rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts. Together our final words. God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. May the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. And as we do and ask for the filling of the Holy Spirit, may the blessing of God Almighty, whose Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you now and forever. So filled with the Spirit's power, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. There is prayer ministry just after the service. Tea and coffee are served. Have a lovely Sunday and see you next week. God bless.